The following presentation of America's hardest prisons may offend some viewers. Viewer discretion is advised.
Wabash Valley Prison in Indiana contains a super maximum security unit. Some of the state's most ruthless and dangerous prisoners are housed here. For its 2,200 inmates, the reality of life inside this prison is hard time. The prison's most dangerous and disruptive offenders are housed in the SHU, the Secured Housing Unit.
Did you refuse a form?
These inmates are the worst of the worst. Prisoners who may have attacked other offenders or guards. Prisoners who refuse to follow the rules. For their trouble, they are locked down 23 hours a day in single cells.
As a nurse here in the SHU, on a daily basis, I can be faced with suicide attempts, drug overdose, and self-mutilators. We're shaking down, and I'll call you back, okay? All right, bye-bye. Shake Estes down again. He says he's going to cut himself by two, so make sure you get it done.
For nurse Marla Gadbury, there's never a quiet day in the SHU.
No, you're on close observation. You're not on
suicide watch. I'm still being watched, ain't I?
Every 15 minutes.
And for what? For what?
Well, you were saying you were going to hurt yourself, so we had to do something.
Now, look at y'all enforce medication on me. Y'all enforce these injections on me. What you expect me to do?
Well, when they decide that you're not in control of yourself, they can do that.
I mean, I was enforced medication on me.
Hang in there.
I'm not as dumb as they think.
I mean, you know, if he's going to fly off the deep end, you don't know it. You could be, you might not have done nothing to him that day, and, you know, he could lash out at you.
How do you get some pills and everything under control?
I've had feces thrown on me. I've had feces hanging out of my hair before. They throw milk, they throw feces, they throw urine. Anything they can get their hands on, they can throw that on you. They do it for different reasons. We have a lot of mental patients in here, psych patients. I'd say probably 50 to 60% of the population in the SHU, probably higher than that, are mental patients. They are on psychotropic medications, and they have anger control problems. They get mad. They have no way of expressing it. They throw things on you. They cuss you. They try to pull you in their cell. Cardwell medication. No, you refuse. Poe. Yeah. Medication. We try to put the medications in an envelope through the door here so they can't grab at you or get at you, because if you open the cuff port, it's easier for them to get their hands out and grab you. We do have chronic diseases over here, hypertension, HIV, diabetes, things of that nature, but the majority of our meds are psychotropics. Hi, Meeks. How you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Depending on their diagnoses, some of them are anti-anxiety drugs, antidepressants, things of that nature. So the side effects do cause them to sleep.
I've been in the SHU for approximately going on 6 years now. I've got a heart condition. It's called Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. It's gotten worse over the last 3 to 4 months. I've had to be hospitalized. I've had to have blood transfusions. And I think that might be what the problem is right now.
Step back. Are they shaking him down then?
Let me get your vital signs and see where you're at, okay?
Mifflin. Who told, how'd you get this information?
Have you been arrested, like we told you to do?
Yeah.
Hey, on Estes, have you talked to him? He says he's got a razor. If we don't, you gonna shake him down?
You already did, many times.
Nothing?
No.
They shook him down, they found nothing.
I shook him down.
Hey, can you
we did. When you told us he was coming on suicide, that's when we shook him down.
Have you shook him down since then?
I shook him down a quarter till 10.
Do it again. Shake him down again. Let us know. We'll call and talk to you. All right. Well, we'll shake him down, and I'll call you back, okay? All right. Bye-bye. On a scale of 1 to 10, Poe, where's pain at? His heart beats rapidly, over 120 beats per minute. He has been taught how to decrease that by breathing techniques. Sometimes he doesn't do that. He likes the tension. Did you try to calm yourself down earlier?
Try deep breathing.
119.
But every time I do,
it's not really packed.
I get real dizzy.
So you're saying you have chest pain? You're dizzy. You can't calm yourself down. What happened between the time you talked to these guys the last time and now that you're feeling so bad?
I just laid down. That's all I did. I did what you told me to do. The pain's getting worse in my chest.
Well, your vital signs are good. Your heart rate is not as high as it normally is. You're not short of breath right now.
No.
No? Well, we'll call. Dr. Joffrey's not here right now, but Kelly Kling is. And we'll call Kelly.
Ask her if I can get a shot.
Think that would help you?
Yes.
What do you want? Please. You're thinking Thorazine or Benadryl? Are you thinking? Why do you think you need that?
I'm feeling real shit. Excuse my language.
I don't think it's... You're in too much danger from your heart right now because your vital signs are good. You're not short of breath. You don't seem to be in an acute distress at this moment. So if you're thinking you need a shot, we'll ask her.
Tell her I'm feeling edgy, real edgy.
You just don't feel right. I'll let you know what she says, okay? Be careful walking.
7640.
Hey, Kelly, it's Marla. Hey, I just seen Poe. He's requesting a shot. I told him that he needed to take his Prolixin, his PO Prolixin. He said he's taking it, but he is requesting either Thorazine, Benadryl, or anything because he says he feels edgy and he feels sick and he just does not feel good.
I got epileptic seizures, man. I had seizures in the shield and they told me to die in the shield, man. That's all I know.
You're back here 24 hours a day. You're locked up at least 23 hours of the day. There's nothing to do.
Hey, Johnny, go down out there, give you bowl to eat food out of with your fingers. Yeah. They won't even give you a spoon to eat your food with.
Yeah, they won't give you a spoon to eat with.
You make them eat with his fingers.
She's got the bottom trays right now.
Bottom trays?
I need top trays.
It's been a month. It's been a month since I've mutilated myself. And I still haven't gotten my privileges back, so. Just one of the punishments of hurting yourself.
I've got a condition. I think it's a schizophrenia. I hear voices sometimes, and when I don't take my medications, sometimes I cut on myself. You know, whenever a chance arises. But mostly, a lot of the guys when they cut on themselves, they do it for attention, so they can get medical care. You know, I use a razor blade or a piece of glass. Or one time I shoved a piece of steel, big long piece of steel, with a point on it. I shoved it through the back of my head. It went all the way through to the skull, passed through the skull, and they said it was about a centimeter away from touching the brain itself. I think I did that mostly because of the voices that was going on in my head, the psychiatric problems that I was having at the time. Yeah, yeah. I definitely wanted them to stop.
Poe.
Yeah?
I told you to put your mattress on the floor.
Huh?
Put your mattress on the floor and lay on the floor, please.
Thank you.
Now listen, I talked to Nurse Kling. She doesn't feel safe giving you any injections till we know what's going on with that, okay? Please put your mattress on the floor and lay on the floor with your head away from the stool.
My head away from the stool. I like that.
You know why?
Yep. Please.
Sometimes when I go out, you know, when I pass out or whatever, sometimes I hurt myself, bust my head, cut myself, and I don't even realize I'm doing it until after, like right now, I'm conscious. You know, I'm fully aware of what's going on around me. The voices aren't an issue. You know, I can talk, I can function on a normal basis. But when I start doing this stuff, I'm no longer in that frame of mind. I go out there, and it takes multiple injections to get me back on track.
These prisoners have just 1 hour a day in which they can release all their frustrations and pent-up energy. Their destination is the prison gym, where an inmate can become an artist, a pool shark, a basketball player, or, most importantly, a strong man. Here in the weight room, these prisoners are preparing for an event that will determine who is the strongest man in the prison. Robert Bell and Rebel Givens are Indiana State Prison champions in their respective weight divisions. Their reputations are about to be tested. There's tension in the air. The competition for the prison's weightlifting championship is about to begin.
The big boys is in the house. Nothing but champions, state champions, baby. Evil in the house.
Everybody's got to go down this end. They want to get a group picture of all you guys.
Representing for the handicap, Stripe. Representing for the handicap.
We're going to start 123, 148, 165, and 181 class. The bigger fellows are going last, just like we always do it. We're going to do all the squatting tonight. We're going to do all the benching tomorrow night. We're going to do all the deadlifts on Monday night. Start warming up, first three classes. We're going to start 10 minutes.
Lifting weights on the street is a little different because you got everything out there to be happy about. But being in prison, here it's in a very oppressive place, so you got to find ways to basically uplift your spirits and not sulk. So this is our kind of way here in the gym.
You know, when we have our bad days, you know, we'll just come in here and we'll release that pain because we don't want to release it on no inmates, you know what I'm saying?
What these weights does, they alleviate a lot of aggression. The one could definitely turn outward toward another human being. It channels all of that negativity and all of that energy built up during the day of not doing anything. This is the glue that keeps us together. But
whenever I give you the okay to squat, my arm go down, I'm gonna say squat too. Go down and come right back up. Don't wait on me. Only I'm going to do after that, I'm gonna tell you the racket.
Now don't wait at the bottom. Okay, bar's loaded.
Here we go. Come
on. Sit it off, LL. Talk to it. Talk to it.
Getting caught. Good eye. Here we go.
racket.
I won the state champ this year in the 220 weight class, but it makes me feel good to be a champ.
State champ? I ain't the champ for nothing.
You got some of the hardcore dudes in prison, you know, and everybody want to be the man in prison, really. You know what I'm saying? They want to shine and want the big name, you know. But sports is what make you shine in here, you know, not what you had on the street. People don't care about that. They don't, you know, that's the same penitentiary stories that you hear every day.
Here we go.
Some critics feel that muscle-building sports like weightlifting make these prisoners more dangerous to other inmates and to the public after they're released. Others feel that they don't deserve the privilege of working out.
Racket. Good job. I refuse to lose. Good job.
All natural, baby.
Good job.
I like when I have to fight something. You know what I'm saying? To take a lot of pain away that I go through. A lot of stress, you know what I mean? That's what we do it for the love of it. For the love of it, yeah.
Good job.
About a year and a half ago, the rivalry between the white and the blacks, it was pretty bad. And this time, they're rooting for each other. They want everybody to succeed. And I noticed that myself. I like that part of it. Because in here, it's not white and black. It's we're all together.
That's the Holy Spirit inside me, man. You know what I'm talking about? Don't look at Hank. Look at what God can do in any man's life.
He always gets fired up. He gets all the rest of them fired up, too, when he does that. You know, he ain't paying attention to everybody else. He's in the zone. He got them all fired up now.
It's a technique sport. You know, if you don't have your mechanics and your technique right, you could really be hurt. I've seen some guys break their backs on the street and in prison doing squats.
Squat! Hit it! Oh, there we go. Come on! We got the dance. Get it. We got it out. Walk it out. Hey, don't worry about it,
Ain't my day.
That's all you got, yours, baby.
This is step one. We got step two and step three to go.
We're gonna have one more left after this. As soon as this is over, I gotta get you back to the house.
We talking about the Lord. We talking about the Lord. We talking about we gonna do it. He had a light here. He come to save the world. The sins of the world. He come to do it.
Good lift.
It's gonna be better. It's gonna be better tomorrow.
Yeah, we win in our weight class. That's the main thing, you know. Yeah, we just going for the all-time personal.
Monday,
you know what I'm saying? Our
Monday's
best.
Monday's gonna
be
the best. Yeah. Just couldn't execute those last two lifts, man. Mm-hmm. I had it, but it just rolled on my neck. I couldn't recover.
Yeah.
You know, because I felt myself here.
Yeah.
Coming up. But yeah. I just could have had to dump.
But you was up higher than there. You was that far from locking out. Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
And we still got two events. We got the bench tomorrow.
Yeah, we winning on
Wednesday. And the deadlift is going to be the best lift. Yeah. It's going to be the best lift.
Let's go. Prison gangs are one of the biggest problems confronting the facility at Wabash Valley. A white supremacist group, the Aryan Brotherhood, is a dominant presence. The gang often preys on offenders who have harmed children, offenders like child molesters and child killers.
If it was up to me, I'd wipe them all out. I mean, if it was up to me, baby rapers, child molesters, fags, all that, you know.
Child molesters wouldn't be too popular anywhere, I would hope. You know what I'm saying? I think they should all be shot and killed.
This attitude was to have a chilling impact on child offender Jesse Anderson, who's facing 60 years in prison for murder.
I was convicted of murdering my girlfriend's little girl.
Child molesters and child killers like Jesse Anderson are regarded as the lowlife of the facility by the Aryans and other white supremacist groups within the facility. Jesse Anderson compounded his problem by presenting himself as simply a murderer and sought to affiliate in one way or another with the Aryans. When they found out what he was actually in for, killing a child, he was blackballed.
I usually don't come out the morning wreck, but somebody come in and told me that a dude I know was outside wanting to talk to me. I went out, and this dude, Kevin Legui, was standing there.
Well, Legui came over to E House, had someone have Anderson come outside. They walked and talked along this sidewalk. They came along here. They continued on down to this sidewalk and down by the Industries building. They met up with the other assailant, and at that time they began stabbing Anderson.
They come from behind me. You know, I didn't see it coming. They stabbed me six times altogether.
It's our belief from what we gathered during the investigation they meant to kill Anderson.
So I took off running, you know, fast as I could. I made it through about half of the rec yard before I collapsed down on my knees.
Emergency personnel arrived, nurses arrived, gave him first aid. We didn't realize how serious it was. He was on a gurney, he had oxygen on him, and we didn't realize at that time that he had a punctured lung. And also, we didn't realize how many stab wounds he had due to the fact medical had covered several of them to prevent bleeding.
These are the two weapons that are believed to be used in the attack. It's a piece of steel. It's approximately 7.5 to 8 inches in length. This one provided the puncture wounds, we believe, during the attack.
I got stabbed six times. One right here went in and hit my lung, which these right here were the chest tube that drained the blood out. Right here, this long one's where they had to crack my ribs to work on my lung. I got three over here, one here, here, here. This one got my liver, which they had to cut here to fix it. I got one in my back there. And I got the one on my arm, which caused tendon damage and some little nerve damage, which has messed my hand up because I can't raise my thumb or my pinky to full extent. They're talking about going back in and reoperating on it. It was pretty bad when it happened. I almost died. Like, if I'd have been 5 minutes more getting to the hospital, I'd have been dead because my lung was filling with blood. My liver was bleeding out.
How are you doing today?
All right.
You want to get up here and we'll get you weighed? Have you had any problems recently?
Not besides the six holes they put in me a couple months ago.
Right. No other complaints?
No.
No excessive bruising or anything?
Nah. Well, I'm a hemophiliac, so if I get bruised, right. It's kind of normal for me.
But you haven't had any excessive bruising?
I didn't know later that there was two people involved and that who they were. I still don't know who one of them was. I don't know his name, but the other one they tell me was a dude I know named Kevin Legui.
I'm here for murder and attempted kidnapping.
serving a sentence of 110 years.
The other dude, he hung himself after the incident. The dude that they got over and got locked up now, Kevin, you know, I've known him 5 years now. It's kind of nerving, you know, knowing that somebody known that long can do something like that. He's gave no reason why he done it, you know, so I can't say. He just...
Why would you want to stab Jesse Anderson? Was it because of his crime? Was that the motivation, or brotherhood, or what?
Let me say something, man. I don't want to talk on this tape, man. I'll be honest with you, I don't want to talk on this tape, man. Y'all can find somebody else to holler at now. Nah, it's about anything, really. I changed my mind, man. I don't want to holler at y'all, man.
You just got to deal with it day by day, you know. It's always there, even when you first come here, even before it happens, you know, you always think, what's going, you know, something might happen. So, you know, it's just, you never know.
I don't think that begins now that he's been stabbed. I believe that Jesse Anderson has been looking over his shoulder every day since he came into the Department of Corrections. Why? Because he knows what time it is. He knows what the offender population thinks of his crime. Crime. And he knows that there are hundreds of people like Legui out there that would stab him or attempt to take his life just simply because of what he has done.
A little harder to deal with, you know, still, than what it was at first. Just had to deal with it.
Are you shaking Estes back down now?
Back in the shoe, suicidal offender Ronald Estes is removed from his cell while it's searched for anything he could use to cut himself. Yeah. Offender Chapman, meanwhile, is confronting his own demons.
Concerning, you think that you, what'd you do, buy a sack lunch off of somebody?
Yeah, I did. The range runner gave me a sack lunch. And,
from who?
From Pozo, and I didn't want the orange. I sent the orange upstairs, and then he told Joe not to eat the orange. That got me scared after I done ate the two sandwiches. He told another man, do not eat the orange.
Okay. And your concern is that you're going to contract?
I'm going to get some kind of disease, whatever's wrong. There would be no reason why he should give it to me and then tell another man not to have it.
You have to share bodily fluids,
this
semen.
This is what I'm stating. Now, if somebody put the bodily fluid on the sandwich and I ate it, could I get that? Yes, I could.
No, not usually. You have to understand how HIV is transmitted. And the virus is not going to stay alive that long anyway. The virus, the HIV virus, can only sustain itself outside of the body for a couple hours.
Right, so, but then I'm just paranoid because a man told me to eat it and then told another man, no, not to eat it.
Okay, I understand that you're paranoid about that, but you...
I have a right to be, wouldn't you?
Well, it's probably has nothing to do with the HIV virus or the hepatitis virus. You were tested for HIV and hepatitis in 99. They were negative.
Right.
6/22 of this year, you were tested again.
Right.
They're negative.
Right.
Our policy is if you had no risk factors, once a year.
Right.
This does not constitute a risk factor. This, you cannot get HIV from eating food.
Okay.
So you should, do you understand that?
What if they soaked the shit in there? If they soaked it in the blood, bodily fluid, or soaked a sandwich in blood and I ate it without knowing. Now soaking the shit in it. That's what
Chapman,
I'm stating.
Chapman. The sandwich you ate.
Right.
Was it covered in blood when you ate it?
I don't know. I just ate the sandwich.
You didn't,
I didn't
look
see
at
blood.
It?
I did not see blood.
Okay.
Now, what about semen? Because semen is, and I didn't see it. Now, if they put it in water, it knocks the smell out of it, and it can still soak through the meat, and you eat it.
That's not very probable.
Well, unless you're having sex or sharing needles or anything like that, you don't need to worry about it, okay?
Okay.
All right.
Now, can I speak? About the beatings and the food and the problems here, about all that. There's to have major, major problems. Officers, look and see how many lawsuits are here. Look and see how many...
Sex.
How many people got lawsuits. Man in cell 601 needs to speak to you if he can. But look at all the lawsuits and the beatings and all the outside cases. It's not just here, it's everywhere.
Gonna go to Wishart. We went like 2 weeks ago and they determined that he had to bleed somewhere.
Johnny Poe's hemoglobin count is now dangerously low, and Marla has decided to send him to the hospital for further tests.
He's been vomiting, so you might want to get the basin.
You got a basin for him to get outside?
Yeah, I do. Thank you. The offender's been complaining for a couple days of nausea and vomiting. He started vomiting blood around 11 o'clock today. We tested his hemoglobin level. It was 7.9, which is really low. So we are sending him to the hospital. He went to the hospital 2 weeks ago for about the same condition. And he was up there for a couple days and then sent him back to us. They determined that he needed more testing and we were waiting. Everything has to be pre-approved. We were waiting for those tests to be approved and so we can implement those. But with his hemoglobin falling, we thought it would be best just to go ahead and send him back up there. Scratching your arm.
Like I said, 2 o'clock.
Let me see. Hurting yourself is not going to help. We're putting you back on suicide watch for 24 more hours.
They told me, I didn't tell them.
So at 2 o'clock, you're going to cut yourself. Is that what you're saying? All right.
Time is running out. It's almost 2 o'clock.
He's known to self-injure, so he'll probably do what he's saying he's gonna do. He's taking his fingers, pulling the wounds apart, his old wounds that he cut last week.
Well, since last Thanksgiving, I lost my wife and daughter in a car wreck. And after that, every around Thanksgiving, it's hard, rough on me. And I've been in prison for the last 3 years, and they came up to visit me at Westville Prison, where I was incarcerated there. They went home right in front of our trailer, drunk driver. I hit them head-on, killed them both. So every time it's around Thanksgiving, I cut myself, and I try to commit suicide or whatever.
I don't know what he's going to cut it with because they've shaken him down. They didn't find any razors or anything, so he's very inventive. Beast Medical, Marla. Hey, I'm sorry to bother you again, but I went out there and explained everything to him. He is sitting in the floor as we speak, pulling the wound apart on his antecubicle. He said that he's going to cut that at 2 o'clock.
When I cut myself, it just released so much energy and so much thoughts and depression and whatever because I don't know how to deal with it other ways right now.
We're gonna put him in 4 points, which four-way restraints, strapped to the bed with leather restraints for 8 hours. We can't give him any injections because he has allergies, lots of allergies to the neuroleptics, high EPS levels. So we have to go to the next thing, which would be we already got him on suicide watch. He was on close observation. We went back to suicide watch. He's still trying to pull the arm apart. So we're going to have to put him in 4 points for self-protection.
I've accepted the consequence. If I do actually hit the artery, each time I've cut myself, I explode an artery to my arms. And I accept the fact if I do die, that's just a fact that I have to accept, and I know the consequence.
They're not that deep. They're not actively bleeding. All right?
These have a double lock mechanism on them. Engage that, they can't get any tight. So it helps us to not get them too tight on him, and helps him not to, when he struggles, if he does, not to get them too tight for himself.
We're gonna put you down for 8 Estes. Okay?
Yep.
After that, you'll be on suicide watch. All right?
Yep.
You're gonna leave these alone? Huh? Why do you wanna move?
You wanna do the other one?
No, I'm not gonna do the other one.
We're gonna be holding ourselves right now.
You know something? This cell ain't built for the safety of people like the dude next door. It ain't built for safety like them. Come, let me show you something. They say people can't kill themselves in these cells. Tie that around. Put it around your neck and slide. Key yourself.
Ronald Estes is placed in 4-point restraints for his own safety. The full cell extraction team is on hand to ensure there are no problems.
And I'm all confused right now, and I don't know what I really want. Do I really want to die, or is it just the way I'm feeling right now?
Self-mutilators. We work well as a team. I've been here 6 years. I'm kind of used to this environment, this in the shoe. I kind of think of it as a MASH unit, you know. They cut themselves, they rush them in here. Back together, you know, we work good as a team. I'm good at it. I like it. I don't know why I stayed. I needed the job.
Day 2 of the prison's annual weightlifting championship is underway. Rebel Givens holds the state prison record for the bench press in the 220-pound division. Tonight, he's going for 420 pounds, 5 pounds above his state record.
You got it. Easy, man. Come on.
Give me my breath. Good job.
Woo! Yeah, feel good. Feel good.
What'd you say?
Can you lift any more?
He
didn't wait for a rack signal. So that 420 pounds was no good. He'll have to lift on his neck, make his third attempt for the record.
I got it, but I racked it too quick. I got to wait for the judges to say rack. All the yelling going around, I couldn't really hear him say it. Yeah.
The noise is too noisy. So next time when you go down, I'm going to have to judge myself and tell everybody to be quiet. Yeah. That way you can be
That's
quiet.
All right. I'm going to get it back.
Oh, yeah.
That's lightweight. That's lightweight.
Brad.
The participants in this event are far from ordinary. Murderers, robbers, rapists and thugs come together in this weight room to compete. The one thing that unites them is their criminality.
This is a dangerous room, because if somebody gets out of line and don't care, take a 5-pound plate and knock you out, you know, you're done. And it's never happened yet. Nobody's used one. We had a guy come out of the basketball court one time, took a plate and was heading out the door with it. We stopped him. He was going to go out there and use it as a weapon. Defender Bell got into it with a fellow over there, and I went and got right in between them, and I probably shouldn't have. They were like face off to each other and doing this thing, you know, and I stopped that because they were both big guys.
Stay focused. 1, 2, 3.
That day he was mad. I knew if I didn't get over and get between them two guys and they got hooked up, I was going to have to call in the troops because I wouldn't have been able to handle it. But he backed off. But, you know, once they got started, you couldn't stop them, not by yourself. But they have enough sense, too, to know that if they ever do anything in here, it's going to go down the tubes. So they protect that a lot.
My money this time.
You know what time, Greg?
Get my money this time, man. That record going to come off tonight. That record, Greg, come off tonight. I'm going to give it to him good. I'm going to give it to him good right here. I'm going to give it to him good.
Bell's getting his bar ready for him. Gibbons is now sitting on the bench. Getting Harry Lane's back, getting a hold of the bar. Waiting for the signal. Here we go. Full lock, down, pause. He's got the press signal.
Weightlifting. A lot of the officers would like to take it out because they think if they get big. But a big old tired weightlifter is a lot less of a threat than a little skinny guy who's out there doing nothing, walking around. Bell and Gibbons come in here and for an hour and a half just give it all they got. They don't have enough energy to get into any trouble when they leave here.
Yeah.
You know, the more I can get them to do, keep their mind off of other stuff, you know, this is a bad place. You know, it's a real bad place. I wouldn't want to live here.
Yeah, I got the record that time. Yeah, I knew I had to come back and get it. I couldn't hear it the first time. I had to focus in on that one. It was 415. I just got 420. We keep the records up on the board over there. The records right here. It's the record right here that I got right here. The 415, I got 420. It's been up here for a year and a half. I missed it. I tied it in the state meet, but you got to go five. You know, you got to go a heavier weight to break it. You can't tie it. It used to be you. It used to be where.
This may be a good night for the weightlifters, but in prison, violence is never far away.
Get your head out! Get your head out! Give me your head!
Quit resisting!
I'm resisting, man!
You are! Quit resisting!
I'm just... They're secure. I'm just big, man! Damn, what the hell I look like?
Get up!
An inmate who shouldn't have been near the gym during the competition refused an officer's order to move away. A fight broke out when the guard attempted to handcuff him, and both fell to the ground.
Yeah, let everybody know how they be doing down at Wall Bear. They be black jumping on black folks.
They try to swerve him down that we down here trying to hurt these folks.
Get your head out!
You gonna jump on me like I tried to do something to you.
Don't hurt me next time.
I didn't bring your head out.
After the incident, the offender, Victor Jackson, was escorted to the infirmary for counseling.
Guys, did anything hurt?
No, I didn't have nothing wrong with me.
You need medical?
No, I don't.
Okay,
I mean, he attacked me. I didn't do nothing to you.
Hey,
you. Let me take
him. Hey, y'all.
Yeah, make sure y'all get this on film. Make sure y'all get this on film. I didn't do nothing. This officer ran up and grabbed me, talking about get away from the door. So he slammed me down and put the handcuffs on me. Try to put the handcuffs on me. Like I did something to him. What y'all gonna do, take me back and beat my ass? Cause I'm black? Yeah, this is the officer right here, the one you got the camera on.
Hey, dude, I'm down your left wing.
My name is Victor Jackson.
He was walking down left wing at this time.
You open left wing. Try to resist for what? I ain't did shit.
Victor Jackson is marched off to segregation, and another battle is over. But after trying to sneak a look inside the gym during the weightlifting competition, Victor has lost the support of some of his fellow inmates.
Yeah, he's gonna get whooped.
Glad y'all coming. I'm glad y'all take that the conflict just now.
He's been asking for that for years. Finally got it.
Next time in Wabash Valley, a violent attack on a nurse. And the results of the weightlifting competition.
I like when I have to fight something, you know what I'm saying? To take a lot of pain away that I go through, a lot of stress, you know what I mean? That's what we do it for the love of it, for the love of it, yeah.
Good job. Good job.
About a year and a half ago, the rivalry between the white and the blacks, it was pretty bad. And this time, they're rooting for each other. They want everybody to succeed. And I noticed that myself. I like that part of it. Because in here, it's not white and black. It's we're all together.
That's the Holy Spirit inside me, man. You know what I'm talking about?
Don't look at Hank. Look at what God can do in any man's life.
He always gets fired up. He gets all the rest of them fired up, too, when he does that. You know, he ain't paying attention to everybody else. He's in the zone. He got them all fired up now.
Power, power, what's your working power? In the blood of man. There is power, power, what's your working power? In the precious blood of man. Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
This is the man that comes in the name of the Lord.
Bless him.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
on it.
Let's go. 5'7".
Just get your reps when you get through that.
It's a technique sport. You know, if you don't have your mechanics and your technique right, you could really be hurt. I've seen some guys break their backs on the street and in prison doing squats.
Squats! Here we go.
Come on.
Got the dance. Get it. Walk it out. Walk it out.
Ain't my day.
That's all you got, yours, baby.
This is step one. We got step two and step three to go.
We're gonna have one more left after this. As soon as this is over, I gotta get you back to the house.
We talking about the Lord. We talking about the Lord. We talking about we gonna do it. He had a light here. He come to save the world. The sins of the world. He come to do it.
Good lift, good lift.
It's going to be better. It's going to be better tomorrow. Yeah,
they came along here. They continued on down to this sidewalk and down by the Industries building. They met up with the other assailant, and at that time they began stabbing Anderson.
They come from behind me. You know, I didn't see it coming. They stabbed me 6 times altogether.
It's our belief from what we gathered during the investigation they meant to kill Anderson.
So I took off running, you know, fast as I could. I made it through about half of the rec yard before I collapsed down on my knees.
Emergency personnel arrived, and nurses arrived, gave him first aid. We didn't realize how serious it was. He was on a gurney, he had oxygen on him, and we didn't realize at that time that he had a punctured lung. And also we didn't realize how many stab wounds he had due to the fact medical had covered several of them to prevent bleeding.
These are the two weapons that are believed to be used in the attack. It's a piece of steel. It's approximately 7.5 to 8 inches in length. This one provided the puncture wounds, we believe, during the attack.
I got stabbed 6 times. One right here went in and hit my lung, which these right here were the chest tube that drained the blood out. Right here, this lung was where they had to crack my ribs to work on my lung. I got 3 over here, 1 here, here, here. This one got my liver, which they had to cut here to fix it. I got 1 in my back there. And I got the one on my arm, which caused tendon damage and some little nerve damage, which has messed my hand up because I can't raise my thumb or my pinky to full extent. They're talking about going back in and reoperating on it. It was pretty bad when it happened. I almost died. Like, if I'd have been 5 minutes more getting to the hospital, I'd have been dead because my lung was filling with blood. My liver was bleeding out.
How are you doing today?
All right.
You want to get up here and we'll get you away? Have you had any problems recently?
Not besides the 6 holes they put in me a couple months ago.
Right. No other complaints?
No.
No excessive bruising or anything?
Nah. Well, I'm a hemophiliac, so if I get bruised, it's kind of normal.
But you haven't had any excessive bruising?
I didn't know the later that there was two people involved and that who they were. I still don't know who one of them was. I don't know his name, but the other one they tell me was a dude I know named Kevin Legui.
I'm here for murder and attempted kidnapping. I'm serving a sentence of 110 years.
We work good as a team. I'm good at it. I like it. I don't know why I stayed. I needed the job.
Day 2 of the prison's annual weightlifting championship is underway.
Number 420 for Gillen.
Rebel Givens holds the state prison record for the bench press in the 220-pound division. Tonight, he's going for 420 pounds, 5 pounds above his state record.
Yeah, feel good. Feel good.
What'd you say?
Can you lift any more?
He
didn't wait for a rack signal. So that 420 pounds was no good. He'll have to lift on his neck, make his third attempt for the record.
I got it, but I racked it too quick. I gotta wait for the judges to say rack. All the yelling going around, I couldn't really hear him say it. Yeah.
The noise is too loud. So next time when you go down, I'm going to have to judge myself and tell everybody to be quiet. Yeah. That way you can be.
That's all right.
I'm
going to get it back.
Oh, yeah.
That's lightweight. That's lightweight.
Brad.
The participants in this event are far from ordinary. Murderers, robbers, rapists, and thugs come together in this weight room to compete. The one thing that unites them is their criminality.
This is a dangerous room, because if somebody gets out of line and don't care, take a 5-pound plate and knock you out, you know, you're done. And it's never happened yet. Nobody's used one. We had a guy come out of the basketball court one time, took a plate and was heading out the door with it. We stopped him. He was going to go out there and use it as a weapon. Defender Bell got into it with a fellow over there, and I went and got right in between them, and I probably shouldn't have. They were like face off to each other and doing this thing, you know, and I stopped that because they were both big guys.
One, two, three.
That day he was mad. I knew if I didn't get over and get between them two guys and they got hooked up, I was going to have to call in the troops because I wouldn't have been able to handle it. But he backed off. But, you know, once they got started, you couldn't stop them, not by yourself. But they have enough sense, too, to know that if they ever do anything in here, it's going to go down the tubes.
On children, offenders like child molesters and child killers.
If it was up to me, I'd wipe them all out. I mean, if it was up to me, baby rapers, child molesters, fags, all that, you know.
Child molesters wouldn't be too popular anywhere, I would hope. You know what I'm saying? I think they should all be shot and killed.
This attitude was to have a chilling impact on child offender Jesse Anderson, who's facing 60 years in prison for murder.
I was convicted of murdering my girlfriend's little girl.
Child molesters and child killers like Jesse Anderson are regarded as the lowlife of the facility by the Aryans and other white supremacist groups within the facility. Jesse Anderson compounded his problem by presenting himself as simply a murderer and sought to affiliate in one way or another with the Aryans. When they found out what he was actually in for, killing a child, he was blackballed.
I usually don't come out the morning wreck, but somebody come in and told me that a dude I know was outside wanting to talk to me. I went out, and this dude, Kevin Legui, was standing there.
Well, Legui came over to E-House, had someone have Anderson come outside. They walked and talked along this sidewalk. They came along here. They continued on down to this sidewalk and down by the Industries building. They met up with the other assailant, and at that time, they began stabbing Anderson.
They come from behind me. You know, I didn't see it coming. They stabbed me 6 times altogether.
It's our belief from what we gathered during the investigation, they meant to kill Anderson.
So I took off running, you know, fast as I could. I made it through about half of the rec yard before I collapsed down on my knees.
emergency personnel arrived, and nurses arrived, gave him first aid. We didn't realize how serious it was. He was on a gurney, he had oxygen on him, and we didn't realize at that time that he had a punctured lung. And also, we didn't realize how many stab wounds he had due to the fact medical had covered several of them to prevent bleeding.
These are the two weapons that are believed to be used in the attack.
Hey, Johnny, both of them, I think if you both eat food out of with your fingers. Yeah. They won't even give you a spoon to eat your food with.
Yeah, they won't give you a spoon to eat with.
You make them eat with his fingers. She's got the bottom trays right now.
Bottom trays?
I need top trays.
It's been a month. It's been a month since I've mutilated myself. And I still haven't gotten my privileges back, so. Just one of the punishments of hurting yourself.
I've got a condition. I think it's schizophrenia. I hear voices sometimes, and when I don't take my medications, sometimes I cut on myself, you know, whenever a chance arises. But mostly a lot of the guys, when they cut on themselves, they do it for attention, so they can get medical care. You know, I use a razor blade or a piece of glass. Or one time I shoved a piece of steel, big long piece of steel, with a point on it. I shoved it through the back of my head. It went all the way through to the skull. It passed through the skull, and they said it was about a centimeter away from touching the brain itself. I think I did that mostly because of the voices that was going on in my head, the psychiatric problems that I was having at the time. Yeah, I definitely wanted them to stop.
Poe.
Yeah?
I told you to put your mattress on the floor.
Huh?
Put your mattress on the floor and lay on the floor, please.
Thank you.
Now listen, I talked to Nurse Kling. She doesn't feel safe giving you any injections till we know what's going on with that, okay? Please put your mattress on the floor and lay on the floor with your head away from the stool.
My head away from the stool. I like that.
You know why?
Yep. Please, sir.
Sometimes when I go out, you know, when I pass out or whatever, sometimes I hurt myself, bust my head, cut myself, and I don't even realize I'm doing it until after, like right now, I'm conscious. You know, I'm fully aware of what's going on around me. The voices aren't an issue. You know, I can talk, I can function on a normal basis. But when I start doing this stuff, I'm no longer in that frame of mind. I go out there, and it takes multiple injections to get me back on track.
These prisoners have just 1 hour a day in which they can release all their frustrations and pent-up energy.
Get you back to the house!
We talking about the Lord! We talking about the Lord! We talking about we gonna do it! He here, the light here! He come to save the world! The sins of the world! He come to do it!
Good lift.
It's gonna be better. It's gonna be better tomorrow.
Yeah, we win in our weight class. That's the main thing, you know.
Yeah,
we just going for the all-time personal.
Monday,
you know what I'm saying? Our
Monday's
best.
Gonna
you know.
Be the best. Yeah. Just couldn't execute those last two lifts, man. Mm-hmm. I had it, but it just rolled on my neck. I couldn't recover.
Yeah.
You know, because I felt myself here.
Yeah.
Coming up. But yeah. I just could have had to dump.
But you was up higher than there. You was that far from locking out. Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
And we still got two events. We got the bench tomorrow.
Yeah, we winning on
Wednesday. And the deadlift is going to be the best lift.
Yeah.
It's going to be the best lift.
Let's go.
Prison gangs are one of the biggest problems confronting the facility at Wabash Valley. A white supremacist group, the Aryan Brotherhood, is a dominant presence. The gang often preys on offenders who have harmed children, offenders like child molesters and child killers.
If it was up to me, I'd wipe them all out. I mean, if it was up to me, baby rapers, child molesters, fags, all that, you know.
Child molesters wouldn't be too popular anywhere, I would hope. You know what I'm saying? I personally, I think they should all be shot, killed.
This attitude was to have a chilling impact on child offender Jesse Anderson, who's facing 60 years in prison for murder.
I was convicted of murdering my girlfriend's little girl.
Child molesters and child killers like Jesse Anderson are regarded as the lowlife of the facility by the Aryans and other white supremacist groups within the facility. Jesse Anderson compounded his problem by presenting himself as simply a murderer and sought to affiliate in one way or another with the Aryans. When they found out what he was actually in for, killing a child, he was blackballed.
As a nurse here in the SHU, on a daily basis, I can be faced with suicide attempts, drug overdose, and self-mutilators. We'll shake him down and I'll call you back, okay? All right, bye-bye. Shake Estes down again. He says he's gonna cut himself by two, so make sure you get it done.
For nurse Marla Gadbury, there's never a quiet day in the SHU.
No, you're on close observation. You're not on
suicide watch. I'm still being watched, ain't I?
Every 15 minutes.
And for what? For what?
Well, you were saying you were going to hurt yourself, so we had to do something.
Now, we're looking at y'all enforced medication on me. Y'all enforced these injections on me. What do you expect me to do?
Well, when they decide that you're not in control of yourself, they can do that.
I mean, I was enforced medication on me.
Hang in there.
I'm not as dumb as they think.
I mean, you know, if he's going to fly off the deep end, you don't know it. You could be, I mean, you might not have done nothing to him that day, and, you know, he could lash out at you.
Sir. Make sure
you
got some pills and everything for control. Make sure you get those things
in. All right. I've had feces thrown on me. I've had feces hanging out of my hair before. They throw milk. They throw feces. They throw urine. Anything they can get their hands on, they can throw that on you. They do it for different reasons. We have a lot of mental patients in here, psych patients. I'd say probably 50 to 60% of the population in the SHU, probably higher than that, are mental patients. They are on psychotropic medications, and they have anger control problems. They get mad. They have no way of expressing it. They throw things on you. They cuss you. They try to pull you in their cell. Cardwell medication. No, you refuse. Poe. Yeah. Medication. We try to put the medications in an envelope through the door here so they can't grab at you or get at you, because if you open the cuff port, it's easier for them to get their hands out and grab you. We do have chronic diseases over here, hypertension, HIV, diabetes, things of that nature, but the majority of our meds are psychotropics. Hi, Meeks. How you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Depending on their diagnoses, some of them are anti-anxiety drugs, antidepressants, things of that nature. So the side effects do cause them to sleep.
To the public after they're released.
I got money,
here we go.
Others feel that they don't deserve the privilege of working out.
Racket!
Stay chill! Yeah.
Good job.
Yeah. I refuse to lose.
Good job. Good job. Good job.
All natural, bro.
Good job.
I like when I have to fight some. You know what I'm saying? To take a lot of pain away that I go through.
A lot of stress, you know what I mean? That's what we do it for the love of it. For the love of it, yeah.
Good job.
About a year and a half ago, the rivalry between the white and the blacks, it was pretty bad. And this time, they're rooting for each other. They want everybody to succeed. And I noticed that myself. I like that part of it. Because in here it's not white and black, it's we're all together.
That's the Holy Spirit inside me, baby. You know what I'm talking about?
Don't look at Hank, look at what God can do in any man's life.
He always gets fired up. He gets all the rest of them fired up too when he does that. You know, he ain't paying attention to everybody else. He's in the zone. He got them all fired up now.
It's a technique sport. You know, if you don't have your mechanics and your technique right, you could really be hurt. I've seen some guys break their backs on the street and in prison doing squats.
Squat!
Hit it! Hit it!
There we go.
Come on!
Drop the dance. We get it. We get it now. Walk it
out.
Ain't my day. That's all you got yours, baby. This is step one. We got step two and step three to go.
We're gonna have one more lift after this. As soon as this is over, I gotta get you back to the house.
We talking about the Lord. We talking about the Lord. We talking about we gonna do it. He had a light here. He come to save the world. The sins of the world. He come to do it.
Determined that he has a bleed somewhere.
Johnny Poe's hemoglobin count is now dangerously low, and Marla has decided to send him to the hospital for further tests.
Yeah, I do. Thank you. The offender's been complaining for a couple days of nausea and vomiting. He started vomiting blood around 11 o'clock today. We tested his hemoglobin level. It was 7.9, which is really low. So we are sending him to the hospital. And it was. He went to the hospital 2 weeks ago for about the same condition. And he was up there for a couple days and then sent him back to us. They determined that he needed more testing and we were waiting. Everything has to be pre-approved. We were waiting for those tests to be approved and so we can implement those. But with his hemoglobin fallen, we thought it would be best just to go ahead and send him back up there. Scratching your arm?
Like I said, 2 o'clock.
Let me see. Hurting yourself is not going to help. We're putting you back on suicide watch for 24 more hours.
They told me, I didn't tell them.
So at 2 o'clock, you're going to cut yourself. Is that what you're saying? All right.
Time is running out. It's almost 2 o'clock.
He's known to self-injure, so he'll probably do what he's saying he's going to do. He's taking his fingers, pulling the wounds apart, his old wounds that he cut last week.
Well, since last Thanksgiving, I lost my wife and daughter in a car wreck. And after that, every round Thanksgiving, it's hard to rub on me. And I've been in prison for the last 3 years, and they came up to visit me.
Wabash Valley Prison in Indiana contains a super maximum security unit. Some of the state's most ruthless and dangerous prisoners are housed here. For its 2,200 inmates, the reality of life inside this prison is hard time. The prison's most dangerous and disruptive offenders are housed in the SHU, the Secured Housing Unit.
Did you refuse a form?
These inmates are the worst of the worst. Prisoners who may have attacked other offenders or guards. Prisoners who refuse to follow the rules. For their trouble, they are locked down 23 hours a day in single cells.
As a nurse here in the SHU, on a daily basis, I can be faced with suicide attempts, drug overdose, and self-mutilators. We're shaking down, and I'll call you back, okay? All right, bye-bye. Shake Estes down again. He says he's going to cut himself by two, so make sure you get it done.
For nurse Marla Gadbury, there's never a quiet day in the SHU.
No, you're on close observation. You're not on
suicide watch. I'm still being watched, ain't I?
Every 15 minutes.
And for what? For what?
Well, you were saying you were going to hurt yourself, so we had to do something.
Now, look at y'all enforced medication on me. Y'all enforced these injections on me. What you expect me to do?
Well, when they decide that you're not in control of yourself, they can do that.
I mean, I was enforced medication on me.
Hang in there.
I'm not as dumb as they think.
I mean, you know, if he's going to fly off the deep end, you don't know it. You could be, you might not have done nothing to him that day, and, you know, he could lash out at you.
How
did you
get some pills and everything for control? Make sure you get those things. All right.
I've had feces thrown on me. I've had feces hanging out of my hair before. They throw milk. They throw feces. They throw urine. Anything they can get their hands on, they can throw that on you. They do it for different reasons. We have a lot of mental patients in here, psych patients. I'd say probably 50 to 60% of the population in the SHU, probably higher than that, are mental patients. They are on psychotropic medications, and they have anger control problems. They get mad. They have no way of expressing it. They throw things on you. They cut.
Weightlifting. A lot of the officers would like to take it out because they think they get big. But a big old tired weightlifter is a lot less of a threat than a little skinny guy who's out there doing nothing, walking around. Bell and Gibbons come in here and for an hour and a half just give it all they got. They don't have enough energy to get into any trouble when they leave here.
Yeah.
You know, the more I can get them to do, keep their mind off of other stuff, you know, this is a bad place. You know, it's a real bad place. I wouldn't want to live here.
Yeah, I got the record that time. Yeah, I knew I had to come back and get it. I couldn't hear it the first time. I had to focus in on that one. It was 415. I just got 420. We keep the records up on the board over there. The records right here. It's the record right here that I got right here. The 415, I got 420. It's been up here for a year and a half. I missed it. I tied it in the state meet, but you got to go five. You know, you got to go a heavier weight to break it. You can't tie it. It used to be where.
I ain't got my hands on you. What
This may be a good night for the weightlifters, but in prison, violence is never far away.
Get your hand out! Get your hand out! Give me your hand!
Quit resisting!
I'm resisting, man!
You are! Quit resisting!
They're secured. I'm just big, man. Damn, what the hell I look like?
Get up!
An inmate who shouldn't have been near the gym during the competition refused an officer's order to move away. A fight broke out when the guard attempted to handcuff him, and both fell to the ground.
Yeah, let everybody know how they be doing down at Wallbad. They be black jumping on black folks. They try to swerve them down that we down here trying to hurt these folks.
Get your hand!
Don't jump on me like I tried to do something to you.
Don't hurt me next time.
I didn't train you how.
After the incident, the offender, Victor Jackson, was escorted to the infirmary for counseling.
Okay, guys, did anything hurt?
No, I ain't nothing wrong with me.
You need medical?
No, I don't.
Okay,
I mean, he attacked me. I didn't do nothing to you.
You got it.